university pulled a police car up on the center of campus in a place where within a few minutes 10,000 people would be moving, going out to lunch. They arrested somebody there because he was a graduate, not a student, and put him in the police car, and everybody sat down around it for 32 hours and captured it. This was the beginning of what became known as the free speech movement. There's a time when the operation of the machine becomes so odious.
The operation of the machine becomes so odious.
It makes you so sick at heart.
That you can't take part. You can't even passively take part.
And you've got to put your body upon the wheels and the levers and the gears.
Upon the gears and upon the wheels, upon the levers, upon all the apparatus, and you've got to make it stop.
And indicate to the people who run it and the people who own it
that unless you're free,
the machine will be prevented from working at all. And we got arrested. I got arrested. I was in there. The students went on strike. Campus shut down. The faculty had their meeting of the Academic Senate just then.
From the Homebrew Computer Club on my far right, the designer of the Osborne 1, co-inventor of the Sol 20, the Penny Whistle Modem, and moderator of the Homebrew Computer Club, Lee Felsenstein. Great to have you.
I'm Lee Felsenstein. I was one of the people involved in the very earliest days of the personal computer. I say that I'm a daydreamer and explainer. I was making weapons, information weapons. But what are they? Well, I had to discover that. In 1973, we didn't have microprocessors, so there was no intelligence in the terminal. And they were coming up with things that could attach to a TV, and you type on a keyboard and it showed the text on the TV, and that wasn't set up well for a terminal use. But I began thinking, okay, how do we make this better? And so in 73 and 74, I did the engineering work to develop a specification, a terminal that could be developed further and expanded further into a computer at such time as we could afford microprocessors. Because in that year, a microprocessor cost $350, which was a lot more, worth a lot more than it is today. In late 1974, my friend Bob Marsh had convinced me to go shares on renting a garage in Berkeley. And he wanted to make some kind of electronic product. And of course, I could provide some engineering assistance. But we were just sharing the room. And he came to me with a magazine, Popular Electronics. Look at this, he said. It said, build your own mini computer. I don't think they mentioned the price, but it's somewhere there. It's like under $500. The damn thing is empty. There's nothing in there. There's just a processor card and a memory card, and that's it. If you want to use it, there's no place to plug things in. And he said, I want to start building boards to plug into that. That'll expand it and make it useful. And so we started a company called Processor Technology. I had been asked to design what I've been writing that specification for, but to do it their way, and of course I did that. And that was the first card that could plug in, because there were sockets for this, plug in to the computer and generate a video signal with text on it. And so we had a display of a portion of memory, small portion of memory, and it was illustrated by text. Now, the text characters came out of a chip that we bought. It had symbols in there for different control codes. And the design was for a card that would plug into the Altair and Altair-type computers. And it gave them video text. And this was amazing at the time. People said so. Then I was asked to design a computer around that display, and that became the Sol, S-O-L-20.
Once I had the computer and had it working, I realized, now I don't need a secretary. Now I don't need all these other things, and I can adapt the computer to do other things for me. My wife is my assistant. She's on the payroll, so to speak, and I pay her a pretty good salary, and she's very happy with that. And the kids enjoy having us all together working, I'm sure. I see a lot more of my children than I ever did before.
VDM1 was the card that would plug in to any S100 computer. The Sol had that plugged in already, but had everything else except the video monitor. It had very nice looking walnut sides, because back in 1974, Bob Marsh had a friend in Wisconsin who knew where to get that wood. And he wanted to design a product around the wood. Maybe a clock, he thought. But then the personal computer arrived.
Sol 20 reflected the idea that computers were for the rest of us as well, for those that had other professions, and perhaps micros might be useful on them. This machine had an 80-character screen, unlike the Apple II, which was only 40. And unlike the Apple, it also had upper and lower case right from the start, so you're able to do word processing with it.
September 1st, 1976, at the first computer show on the East Coast, the PC76 in Atlantic City. We were taking orders. We weren't able to fill the orders until 1977, but everybody was doing that in those days. In a sense, I argue that I was designing the first personal computer. But not everybody agrees with that. Then in 1975, personal computers arrived as kits and not very fully developed. A lot of us came together to look at the first ones we could get. The origin of the Homebrew Club was centered around a little newspaper called People's Computer Company. It was put out like five times a year. It was run like an underground paper. No, they don't have underground papers today. We have alternative papers, but you could come in and talk about your idea. They would print it. The person who ran that was Bob Albrecht, and he deserves a tremendous amount of credit, because he started out by bringing kids together with computers.
In the Menlo Park community, a group of people are making a major concerted effort to give all its residents a chance to try the computer. The whole project started with an idea called Computer Town USA. It began here as the brainchild of Bob Albrecht and Ramon Zamora, who is now project director.
He brought grade school children into their computer show, where they're showing to the professional viewers, and showed how they could learn how to use this big computer. Now, that was an important demonstration, but his managers didn't think so, and they got rid of him. He loved beer, especially a certain type of beer called steam beer. He wanted to call the club the Steam Beer Computer Club. Well, we compromised on Homebrew Computer Club. This was not really an organization. It was just a forum. We met the first meeting to look at an Altair computer and tell each other about what we knew about it. And everybody knew a little bit about it. The first meeting of the club was held in March of 1975 in a garage, and 30 people attended. Steve Wozniak was one of them. I was one. Most of the people, you wouldn't recognize the names of most of them. Some of them became important during the early days of personal computers, and then that all faded away. Suggested that we pass around a list of names and descriptions of what we had done, what we wanted to do, what we had, what we needed. The club was a kind of social media.
You could get a computer you could think of as a home computer for an amount of money that you thought was okay. But by the time you got through with it, or it got through with you, you had spent almost 10 times the amount of money, you'd spent a much longer time, and you had had to dig in and learn the hard way, which is the best way.
And so at the second meeting, it was decided we'd call it the Homebrew Computer Club. That was all there was to that. And of course, the idea is homebrewing computer, making them at home. We were doing that.
You had to learn about hardware if you thought you were only going to do software, or if you thought you were only going to plug a program in. Well, there was nothing to plug in. There was nowhere to plug it in. The thing didn't have any eyes and ears.
I found a computer manual. I started learning what real mini computers were. I found other manuals on chips, and I started designing my own. I had no books that told me how to.
You had to seek out people to help you in all of these matters. You had to get advice, and you had to learn to give as well as you got.
That was sort of how I got my positive feedback in the world. I felt that I was something. The rest of the world didn't think microcomputers were going to amount to anything. I just thought I had a neat one for my house. I'm going to show others. I'm going to even help them build their own.
And of course, it's a kind of an irreverent title. You're not going to name a serious business that. And we weren't a serious business. We weren't a business at all. We weren't even an organization. We did form a corporation, a nonprofit corporation. I was a member of the board. There were 5 members of the board. And as a trick, you can ask, how many members did the Homebrew Computer Club have? Legally, it had 5 members. But the board meetings were just to run a nonprofit corporation. I made it clear when I said we were incorporated and told the group that no, we're not going to have politics. We're not going to jockey for position in taking this over. Taking it over doesn't take over anything. This is my show and I can take it anywhere I want. We would have a meeting in 2 parts. First, people would stand up from the audience and say, stand up so they could be identified. I need this, I have this, talk with me during random access, which was the second section. And during that random access session, everybody came out of their seats and went onto the floor of the auditorium, knew who they wanted to talk to, and went and talked with them. When Steve Jobs showed up there, which was in the spring of 1976, just before they brought the Apple I down, he didn't have anything to say from the audience. But when we all went down to the floor, he ran madly around the place, trying to listen to every conversation, an impossibility. But that's what he wanted. I think he did that 2 times. And when Apple I was brought there, it wasn't all that exciting. But most of us were working with the other processor, the 8080, and they were using the 6502, which went into the Apple line. And we thought, well, that's kind of an oddball. It's not too relevant. They were out in this lobby. They didn't come into the floor and take over the meeting. And they had a pretty generic computer on a board with a video display. That was unusual. Now, as for things I've done, I can lay claim to being the developer, I guess, although other people did most of the work, for the first social media system using computers that was open to the public. Three generations of that system, and I financed it from the proceeds from Osborne Computer, and I want to do the 4th. I've already got it on the planning underway. I hope I'll get the opportunity to do that in the 10 years or so that are remaining to me.
This one is Carl Farrington, Farrington. Mm-hmm.
He designed the third version of community memory. This is Michael Rossman, who is a kind of philosophical forebearer of community memory. I ran into his writings in 1969 when it was still before he had published them. And he had been important in the free speech movement. And I brought him in. This is Phil Kohn, K-O-H-N, programmer. This is me. This is Karen Paulsell, P-A-U-L-S-E-L-L, who is one of our stalwarts. This is Ken Kolstad, C-O-L-S-T-A-D. He was one of the three founders of Community Memory Project, along with me and Ephraim Lipkin, who is not in this picture. Glasses. Terry Beynart, B-E-Y-N-A-R-T. I think that's who that is.
Terry Beynart.
She was a girlfriend of Carl, okay, and a programmer in her own right. Community Memory version 4. We've solved many, many problems. It's going to run on phones, and it's going to implement the metaphor of the book. We will move from scrolls, like papyrus scrolls, to books, something we did with paper many centuries ago. But we haven't quite made it on social media. I want to get that out as open source, because there isn't time for me to make a lot of money on it. And I don't think I should, because with open source, so many people get to apply their creativity to it. There's no barrier to that. This is on a TV show where I was momentarily famous. We start with imagination. We dream up something, and then we see what parts of it we can realize with the technology we know about. Now, some of that technology is out in the future for social media, but I want to try to concentrate on the daydreams and the concepts, because they aren't going to be given to you by people with money.
Get your thinking off the straight line, off the point A to point B. Step back, take a look, a bigger look, a wider look. Try to figure out what might work for you, not just what somebody else did.
You'll only get from them ways in which they can make more money. And somebody will make money off of this stuff, but it won't be done best if it isn't following people's dreams, their sense of play, and their love for other people.